Alright, thank you for your patience, my people. Dwight said, what up, Paul?
What up, Dwight?
So, I was watching the, Paul and I were having a discussion yesterday, and then I got a chance to watch Obama's, his speech, his farewell speech last night. So we thought it would be fitting to have a conversation about, Dwight. Now, I didn't put it on Facebook Live yet, this time, Dwight, because most of the people watching are off of Instagram anyway, and on live on Facebook, not that many people watch, nobody watches, as a matter of fact, on live. So I said, let me just do Instagram to make my life easier, and I can always upload it to Facebook later.
Yeah.
But one of the things that we felt it would be appropriate to do today was talk about Obama's legacy as he's getting ready to step into another phase, no longer going to be president. And we want to talk about his legacy and also the implications for the people of this nation, the world, and just everybody going forward, black people, white folks, whatever. So that's what we're going to kind of have a conversation about today.
Mm-hmm.
Before we get to that, let me ask my man Paul, anything from the past week that you think would be anything interesting happen? You do anything interesting? You learn anything interesting? Anything that you want to share with the folks?
Random, but what was that deal with Derrick Rose, huh? What's up with what's up with the Knicks though, man?
Man, and I'm annoyed because we're from New York. Dwight, you from New York also. See, you might be happy because, see, aren't you from Massachusetts, I think? But I don't know what's up with your boy, Derrick Rose. Like, I don't understand how, as a professional athlete making millions of dollars, you just don't show up. Like, in any other job, you would basically be fired, yo. Nate, what's good, man? In any other job, you would be fired.
Or at least get suspended or something.
Or suspended or something like that. Like, you would actually be fearful of not showing up to work.
Yeah.
And my man Derrick Rose said, I'm not going to show up, and I'm not going to call and let anybody know that I'm not showing up. And I'm just like, yo, this is crazy. And this is me thinking, like, yo, you got Carmelo Anthony, Derrick Rose, Joakim Noah, and my man Porzingis. And we should have like a solid, maybe not the best, but a solid basketball team.
Yeah.
Right? And we still look very, very average. Very average.
Amateurish, man.
Killing me right now, man.
I don't even know what happened. And like, they never explained anything in terms of why it was just like he had a family emergency or whatever. Mm-hmm. And he didn't feel like calling or picking up the phone. And then I read something today. He was saying that he was thinking about walking away from basketball or something like that.
Wow.
So I don't know what happened, but the Knicks have been whack the last few weeks, man.
And honestly, struggling. Derrick Rose has been through a whole lot. You know what I'm saying? His two injuries. He's not playing anywhere near what we know he could be playing, the level we know he could be playing at.
Even though he's playing better this year, though, than he has been the last 2-3 years. Like, this is the best he's ever looked.
And I don't deny that.
Yeah.
But still, compared to what we know
about
Derrick Rose, what we've seen from Derrick Rose,
compared to what he could have been,
Derrick Rose ain't nothing near where he used to be.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yo, I don't know why I can't find my notes. I'm still fishing for those. But I know for me, as far as interesting stuff, so for me, thank God, but I will be operating at a new position at a prominent and formidable nonprofit in the Washington, D.C. area, doing professional development as a professional development specialist for this nonprofit.
Nice.
And we deal with a lot of folks who have gone through homelessness. We deal with a lot of folks who have gone through substance abuse or what have you, challenges, mental illnesses and challenges or what have you. And so I will be in charge of basically developing, appreciate you, appreciate you. I'll definitely be in charge of setting up curriculums or what have you, teaching them job skills, teaching them soft skills, as some of you might call it, and really helping them to get acclimated to the professional world, you know, teaching them how to deal how do you deal with a boss? You know, how do you write a very good resume? What are the interviewing skills that you need? And I'm actually looking forward to learning because one of the things that I had to do to get the job was I had to do a class for their population based on interviewing skills. And man, I blew that. Not to toot my own horn, you know what I'm saying? Not to toot my own horn, I blew that joint out the frame. It was strong. To the point where they were like, yo, we hope you get the job, you know what I'm saying? So that was just a blessing. And what I really want to do is really hone my skills so that I can take it outside the workplace area, because we all know a bunch of, you know, young adults and even older adults, a lot of them also, who need to understand how do you apply. And Dwight, you know, a lot of this stuff comes from, you know, the Parachute book, but understanding how do you get jobs in 2017? Not how you get jobs in 2008, not how you get jobs in 2009, 2010, not how you get jobs in the 90s or in the 80s, but what does applying for and getting a job look like in 2017? How to be most effective at that? Nice. So that you can really take advantage of what is out there. There are jobs out there, but we don't necessarily know how to get it because we've been operating based off of like a 2008 model, and we got to get current, you know what I'm saying? So it's my goal to hopefully teach more and more people how to do that and what have you. So that's just some of what I will be doing. That's just a little bit of what I'll be doing.
Congrats.
Paul, anything else you want to share? As I look for, really what I'm doing also, y'all, is I'm stalling so that I can find these notes. Yo, I feel like, yo, like they just disappeared. Like, they were literally right in front of me this morning, and I don't know where they went. Hold on, give me 1 second. I'm finding this.
And then the Cavs go and pick up Kyle Korver, son, as if they needed any more shooters already.
Really?
On their squad. Yeah, you didn't hear about that?
No.
Yeah, they traded for him, man.
Yo, I'm looking forward to that.
If you're the Hawks, how are you going to send somebody like that to the Cavs, son? Like, who would trade with the Cavs? And for nothing. It's not like they got anything serious back.
Well, if the Hawks are maybe looking to rebuild, and it doesn't make sense for them to keep him.
Yeah, but still, at least get like a good piece or like a. I guess they got a draft pick out of it, but it's like trading with the Warriors. Like, you're gonna just give them an extra player so they could win the chip easily.
But who would they trade? Who would they trade for? You know what I'm saying? Like, I mean, who would you expect the Warriors to actually give up?
No, I'm just saying it would be like. If you're another team in the West, like, why are you going to trade, give the Warriors a good piece,
a good player? Hold on, who you said traded
for him? The Hawks. They gave Kyle Korver to the Cavs. Mm. So I'm like...
Maybe they don't expect to do anything really in the East.
Well, yeah. That just means they're giving up pretty much.
Yeah. All right, so we'll get started anyway. Paul, so I hope some of y'all at least saw... Appreciate you. Team fed up. Appreciate you, man.
Team fed up.
Here it goes right here. I'm bugging. So I hope that some of y'all. Oh yeah, you already know, Gab. You already know. Track and field. We was doing it up. You know, and I'm proud to see you. I know that you had your mom now and all that kind of stuff. Yo, keep on doing it. All right, keep on doing it. So I hope that some of y'all got to see the speech last night, and maybe some of y'all also saw Michelle's interview that she had done with Oprah. So I want to talk about that just a little bit. Mm-hmm. So Paul, if you can, tell us a little bit. Did you see the speech?
Nah.
You didn't see it?
Well, we were playing, but I caught a little bit of the end of it.
Either way, What do you think of Barack? So you saw all the tears. Everybody's crying that Barack is leaving. Yeah. You know, I never thought that I myself would get emotional off of like a president leaving. It's not like the president knows me personally,
yeah.
But I do think that he was a president who, you know, talking about President Barack Obama, was a president who really did care about the personal lives of the people that he was the president over as the leader of this nation. I really feel like he cared for people,
yeah.
And he wanted to empower people. So based on that, yo, look who walked in, Randall and Bethany. What's up,
yes,
y'all?
Yes.
Y'all got to be quiet, come right on in. So based on the fact that, like, I saw myself getting choked up, right? I shed a tear, y'all. I shed a tear at the fact that, you know, the president was leaving. And I just never expected to, like, feel that way about an elected official. And I guess it kind of reminds me of how many people may have felt, like, during John F. Kennedy days or what have you. Maybe even going back to our earlier presidents, like your George Bush's, or I'm not your George, your George Washington's, or what have you. So, Paul, my question to you is,
Bethany, come.
See,
I saved the seat just for you.
My question to you is, what do you like? What do you think about? What do you think? I'm trying to be in a picture. They hogging. my question to you, Paul, is what do you think will be Obama's legacy? What has he meant for the country? What do you think he will mean going forward? And of course, the other y'all can chime in at some point. But Paul, we'll start with you, man. What do you think?
Yeah, man. I don't know. I think that I think part of the emotion, especially yesterday, and just realizing that Obama's leaving, has a little bit to do with who's coming after him. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think the emotions wouldn't necessarily be as strong or as palpable if it was...
if it wasn't relative.
Yeah, like, if the change wasn't going to feel so stark, like with the next president, you know what I'm saying? And so I think that's part of what people are feeling.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, I think his legacy is going to be what he campaigned on, like,
mm-hmm.
the idea of hope,
mm-hmm.
the idea of change,
mm-hmm.
you know, the idea of... inspiring people to think of everybody as American. You know what I'm saying? I think that's what he did. That's what he campaigned on. And I think that's kind of what that's how he, I don't want to say ruled, but what's the...
governed.
Yeah. That's how he governed, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, I don't know. For me, he just felt so authentic. Like, everything he does feels authentic. Like, it feels like he really cares about the people, he cares about the people that he governs, he cares about the people that he serves, and he sees it as a public service, you know what I'm saying? It never felt to me like he was just power hungry, or he just enjoyed being in control of things, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, so I think that's going to be his legacy ultimately, you know, as the time goes on.
Mm-hmm.
Just the fact that he brought about change, obviously the first black president,
mm-hmm.
and...
Mm-hmm.
And then I think, you know, the Affordable Care Act, the
mm-hmm.
things that he did with healthcare, I think that's going to have a real lasting impact on the country. And, you know, even though they probably going to repeal it.
Well, I've heard some people talk about
that.
Yeah. I was listening to the Weeds just today, and you know, the young lady was talking, one of the young ladies on there was talking about, hey, what's going on, Cynthia? One of the young ladies on there was talking about how she felt like it's not going to be as easy to repeal it as possible.
Yeah,
you know
yeah.
Saying? And I agree, it probably won't.
Well, it's easy to repeal, but it's not easy to replace.
Right,
you know what I'm saying?
Right, right. So. And that's something strong that they're going to have to consider in terms of trying to repeal it.
Right.
But since you're outnumbered, Beth, you know, I don't want to be considered a sexist, so I want to give you an opportunity to speak on what you think Obama's legacy will be from your perspective, especially this perspective of a black woman.
Okay, so I feel like there's just so many things that kind of feed into his legacy. It's not just his, not just like the things that he did in the forefront, but the things that he did in the background as well. So a lot of people that I've been talking to have been talking about like how he didn't do a lot for like race relations in America.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like it's hard being the first black president.
Sure is.
And you can't go in with like this iron fist, like, I'm gonna do all this stuff for black people, I'm gonna do all this stuff for Latinos. Yeah. But like when you look at all the things that he did in the background, the times that he spoke out in favor of justice, whenever there was like a shooting or anything like that, he always spoke out about it. He always made sure that America was aware, like, these are still my people, you know? I think that the things that he did in terms of like My Brother's Keeper, which is an initiative for blacks and browns, black and brown men, I think that the things that he did in terms of clemency, the things that he did in terms of just being a president for...
Cynthia said, preach.
Just being a president for all people inspired, makes me realize that I wasn't just a number, I wasn't just a person. Like, even though I've never like formally met him, it still felt like he was the president for me. Right. And as a black female, even seeing, like, you see like the stereotype of like black men, just seeing him and his family like run this country with class and grace and without scandal and just like being a person that the whole world loves except for his own country, like, that's just something that's something I think will be in his legacy as well.
Yeah. Randall, man, how about your perspective, bro?
Yeah, I mean, you all really summed it up, you know, but I would say, and probably align more closely with what you said, Bethany, that it's really about how he makes us feel, right? I heard you, Vaughn, talking about, like, you got emotional, man. Right, and the same thing happened for me. I've never felt that way about any politician, black, or any race. And it literally felt like a family member was moving abroad. Yeah. Like, you know what I mean? And I think it's because he had a unique ability, man, to just reach people and to create a sense of solidarity amongst particularly the black community, right? And other communities as well, but speaking from that perspective, like, whether you know, align more with the part of his story that, you know, he didn't have a father in the home, right? He was raised by a mother and grandparents, or whether you align with the fact that, you know, he was college educated, you know, he married black, you know, things like that make a difference. He had Common and other rappers in the White House, like, you know, so even though he came from, he was raised by white family members, there was still... He could reach every type of population within that because of the uniqueness of the story. But I also think, man, that he had a heavy burden. I mean, because he was the first, but he also was contrary to how we previously defined and understood and perceived black politicians, particularly male. Right? When you look at, especially those who champion social justice, particularly for the black community, you look at you know, Al Sharpton, Jesse Nardo, and even though at times we'd be like, you know, right on to what they're saying, sometimes you'd be a little embarrassed, man. You know what I'm saying? Like they don't necessarily represent, I want to be careful saying this, the best in us, but
or maybe, well, the thought that comes to mind is the full act, the full range of who we are, you know what I'm saying?
Like you don't, he didn't confirm stereotypes to a certain, and I think not necessarily. I don't necessarily think that's always a good thing or something that you should seek to avoid at all costs. Mm-hmm. But I think that's what's contributing to the appeal that he has on people. So I'll keep it short for now. I'm trying to get into some of the other stuff.
One of the things that that came to mind is his patience. You know what I'm saying? As a patient leader, because as you said, like when you talk about the angry factor, this is a man who has got a lot of pushback from his opposition. You know what I'm saying? In ways that what we're seeing now with, let's say, Trump, right? And this is not a Trump bashing segment or anything like that, but you're talking about a man has been elected president and everybody's up in arms because of what we're hearing. But we're forgetting that this stuff was all Trump was doing this to Barack 8 years ago. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? And right now, we feel like a nation that has to deal with this. But this is Barack by himself dealing with all of this, from not just from Trump, but from a bunch of other people also, right? So I'm like, yo, you never saw him get to this point where he's like, he just started governing out of frustration. You know what I'm saying? Making decisions whatever, I'm just do what I want to do, what have you. Yeah. At every single point, he's always trying to consider, in my opinion, the feelings and the thoughts of even folks that don't agree with him.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And he's trying to say, yo, listen, the best policy doesn't have to come from me. But as long as we're out there working together to try to find the best policy, yo, I'm down for whatever. Mm-hmm.
And that's
know?
Even seen in how he's responding to the repealing of the ACA. Mm-hmm. He's just like, okay, I never said it was gonna be perfect, but this is the best thing you have now. If he has something better, you let me know. Mm-hmm. I will happily endorse it.
right.
There's nothing there. So
right.
It's just like, okay.
Right.
So
yeah, and it's kind of tough too, because you know, we were talking about how he could appeal to various audiences, right?
Mm-hmm.
And how his story still kind of aligns with the Black community. Sometimes, though, when he would speak about his faith in America and who America truly is, and how there's no black or white America, it created a little bit of dissonance, right? Because he had to, while being relevant to us, he still had to maintain and reassure others that don't look like us, that he was still still had them in the best interest, and he was rejecting this narrative of black grievance and black, just struggle, right? Because he had to be something different than what we had already seen, and it's tough because he had to be on both sides, man, and that's a tough thing to do.
Yeah.
I don't know if he so much rejected it, because I mean, he was the Black president. He was facing it every single day. So to say that he rejected this, there's no Black, no white, or whatever, kind of makes it seem like then what was the issue his entire 8 years with Congress and things like that. So I don't know if rejection is the word so much as maybe he didn't let that, he tried to run the country in a way that wasn't always. He didn't let it deter him from what he needed to do.
Right, and it is semantics. So I agree with you wholeheartedly. And when I think of reject, it's to not let it consume him, and not let that be the sole kind of influence on the way he responds to things that go on in this country and government.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so he doesn't allow that to, you know, overtake him or permeate all of what he stands for.
Paul, jump in there.
Because I'm just
there. as they're talking.
No, but this is a good conversation, because this is this is an issue that some people in the Black community have had with President Obama, is that they don't really feel like he did enough for Black people or for, you know, Black America. And even, who was it that we were listening to that said that,
The
Breakfast
Club. The Breakfast Club. I forget the name of the guy, though. But, and Ta-Nehisi Coates has that argument as well. But he has a beard, a big beard.
Yeah. Oh, Umar Johnson?
Umar Johnson. But, but like I said, that's not part of his narrative. Like, he is, and that's why I feel like this is truly who he is. Like, he really is an idealist, and he really does believe in America and the ideals of America, and that America ultimately is not black or white, that ultimately we are all Americans, and if we can all just come together and not only but relate to one another as Americans, that we can almost go beyond those kind of issues. And so that's kind of how he's approached the race relations and those kind of things, even though he's spoken out to some extent. But it was never to the Al Sharpton or Jesse Jackson level, because he never had that kind of resentment that those guys have towards, you know, the white race or towards, you know, the others. You know what I'm saying?
I completely agree, man. And it's just tough, though, because like one thing that Ta-Nehisi Coates said as well, man, was that we spoke about that sense of proximity to what mm-hmm. our experience is, right?
Yeah.
He had his own experiences unique to him, and you know, there's no hierarchy in terms of who had it worse.
Right, right, right.
But at the same time, when he Ta-Nehisi Coates was talking about his father, you know, being targeted by the government because he was involved with the Black Panthers, mm-hmm. that by nature, mm-hmm. right, transforms and changes your perception of what government can do for me.
Right.
When you haven't had to deal with that, mm-hmm. right? So I think we have to acknowledge that President Obama, though authentic and though he is authentically Black in every way, even though he is half white, mm-hmm. right, or 100% white, 100% Black, however you want to articulate that, yeah. that there is still some distance between him and the people, the Black people who are struggling the most here. In the same way that Hillary Clinton had that much distance with the white people who were struggling the most in this country.
I like how Todd, though, brings out the point that Barack actually chose to walk into his Blackness, right? Which, and this will even bring up another conversation somewhat about race, also that form you and I were having this conversation, but just based on what we're talking about now, imagine that Barack is brought up by his white relatives, right? And he experiences, like Todd says, the best that whiteness has to offer, right? Just so to speak, right? And he could have, he could have simply been a person who chose not to go the route of saying, I'm going to work in Southside Chicago, you know what I'm saying, working on issues that
predominantly... Remember, he grew up in Hawaii.
Exactly, and he grew up in Hawaii, you know what I'm saying? Right. So he had no real reason to run toward Black issues the way that, let's say, some of us who grew up in predominantly Black areas would run toward Black issues, because everything surrounding him said that, yeah, I am Black, but everything surrounding me isn't necessarily Black in the same way that we experience that Blackness, right? Not that it's a lesser or greater than, it's not right. a value kind of thing, it's just what your experience is. But he chose to walk towards that. He chose to write books that deal with like his Blackness and what he's choosing to identify with, you know what I'm saying? So it's just interesting that I think we forget about that side of it sometimes, that like, yo, this is a person who didn't have to do as much as he even did, because his experience wasn't the experience that we had, but he saw that there's a problem going on. He said, yo, listen, I'm going to be one of those that runs toward the problem and not try to run away from that thing, you know? But something that we, and Paul, maybe you can speak to this person, then maybe the others can weigh in, but we spoke a little bit about when we talk about being Black and when we talk about being white, and I think it's relevant because we talked about how Barack tried to be this unifying force, right? Can you talk to us a little bit about some of the challenges that we were kind of just thinking back and forth about, like the challenge of even identifying first with being Black or first with being white or first with being something else, first with being a woman or first with being a man, as opposed to identifying first with being a human being?
And, well, let me just say the last thing about this Obama is that... Nah, like, ultimately, he would not have been elected if uh-huh. he was different than who he is.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if he was not somebody who kind of rose above the Black versus white dichotomy, pretty much, and who had a lot of resentment and who was one of those, you know, Jesse Jackson types, like, he never would have been elected, ultimately. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And so... like, we can't just now come and say, well, this is a flaw in his character, when he would have never been president if he was not the way that he is. But to go back to this next topic, well, ultimately, I think this is what this election came down to. It was one of identity. This was a question of identity. Like, what does it mean to be American? You know what I'm saying? Hillary Clinton ran on the premise that... we are all American, and that we don't have to be afraid of the others. We don't have to be afraid of, you know, those coming from other countries, the Mexicans, Muslims, whoever, that all of us ultimately are immigrants to this country.